Brave Like My Brother by Mark Tyler Nobleman. October 10th, 1943. Dear Charlie, I'm so sad about Grandma, but I'm glad she didn't suffer in the end. I wrote Mom a long letter. She already feels like she's lost a son, and now she's lost a mother too. But she was spending so much time helping Grandma that she never had time for herself. So maybe this will be some kind of relief for her. Is that a horrible thing to say? So much about my life in Ohio seems like only a dream now. Milton's, the neighborhood, even the sound of your voice, the memories aren't so clear anymore. It's been only a year and a few months, but war makes each day a week. Matt's wrist is mostly healed. The closer we get to our larger mission, which the commanders are still keeping us boys mostly in the dark about, the more I see a side of Matt he didn't really show before. He's scared. I can tell because he's finally talking about his life back home. Out of nowhere, he told me a story about his brother Richard, about how he once got his arm stuck between fence posts. It was just the two of them there. At first, Matt just laughed at him. But then Richard stopped crying. Yes, stopped. He was still scared, but he wanted to show his big brother that he wasn't. And that was when Matt helped get Richard's arm out. I don't know why Matt shared that story with me, or maybe I do, but he wouldn't confirm or deny if I asked, so I didn't bother. I don't blame Matt for being scared. We all are, even Cookie. He ran off and hasn't come back. Soon we'll wish all we had to deal with was mud, bad food, and lone spies. On top of pushing us harder on our daily training exercises, now they're teaching us a foreign language. Can't tell you which one, because it's where we're going next. Word is, the sensors are so overworked that they're missing stuff in letters, so maybe I could tell you and they wouldn't notice. Or maybe they'd miss it just because my handwriting is famously bad. Remember when Grandma said you're the only one who can read it? Sometimes I feel like you're the only one who can read me. Thanks for listening always. Love, Joe. December 7th, 1943. Dear Charlie, Pearl Harbor was 2 years ago today. Some of the boys are mumbling that if not for that, we would be home with our families for the holidays. They're right, but what's the point? It happened. We're here. There's no way back, and there's only one way forward. This anniversary and the thought of what's next has had some kind of effect on Matt. First thing this morning, before we were ordered to crawl into small holes and sit there for hours, the way we might have to do in a battlefield, Matt told me something. It turns out that he had suggested naming the dog Cookie as a way to tease me about being a cook. I hadn't realized. Even if I had, it wouldn't have been any more obnoxious than anything else he said or done. But then he said the joke was too dumb to be mean. He got that right. And then, get this, he asked about you. He asked about how you're doing with me still away. He asked if anyone was still bothering you. He said Richard's not doing so great. I said I understand. It might be the only thing Matt and I have in common. We're both doing this so you and Richard never have to. Love, Joe. June 5th, 1944. Dear Charlie, I have a feeling this will be the last time I can write you for a while. Please don't worry. It means something happened. But it doesn't have to mean something bad happened. So, I have two confessions. If that's the right word. One about the war. The other about me. That full-sized rubber tank Matt and I had to transport? No. I can't bring it home for you. But I will tell you now what it was for. I don't know if this will get past the censor, but here goes. We're going into France. To get there, we are going to have to cross the English Channel, the body of water between England and France. We wanted to fool Hitler into thinking we were somewhere else in England. That way the Nazis wouldn't be waiting at the real invasion spot. So the Allies came up with a doozy of a plan. We created a fake army. And by fake, I mean inflatable. The tank Matt and I transported was one of the first, a test. Many more were produced. It wasn't just tanks, also boats and planes, and even small buildings, I think. These things were set up to look like a real base, and soldiers were stationed there to act like they would if it were a real base. The idea is that if any German planes flew over, they'd hopefully believe that our forces were bigger and closer than they had thought. Ira said it's like a stage play where the stage is the entire outdoors and the audience is the entire world. And we think our rubber army worked. We'll find out soon enough. The other confession is harder, even harder than military life in a way. But I owe it to you. Maybe I am a good brother, Charlie, but I'm not the man you thought I was. This war is about to get 10,000 times more intense, and I don't feel any more ready than I did when I got here 2 years ago. It's not the Army's fault. They did the best they could to do with me. Don't get me wrong, I'm gonna give this my all, but everyone's all different. And what gets me hardest of all about this is that I left to protect my country when I could barely protect my family. I tried to help you, but in the end it didn't quite work. And then I left you on your own. I know coming here wasn't my choice, but that doesn't make it sting less. What I'm trying to say is, whatever happens, Charlie, you have my blessing to stop looking to me as your role model. Instead, pick someone who sets out to do something and then really does it. I want you to grow up to be a guy like that. Wow. I don't feel better now that I told you. But what will never change is that I love you. Wish me luck, Joe. August 2nd, 1944. Cleveland, Ohio. Home of Superman and other things. Dear Joe, it's all different now. For one thing, this is the last letter I'll write you. People are saying we're going to win the war, but I don't think so. Not because of you and the other soldiers. You did a great job. The reason I don't think we'll win is because so many people have been killed. That doesn't feel like winning to me, even if we do beat the Nazis. Being out there at war is harder than staying home, but when you're in the war, people dying is everyday life. I know they don't always die in front of you, but it's never far. You know how it looked where they died. You know how they looked. You get used to it, I bet. But back home, we don't know. That makes it scarier. It's like monster stories in comic books. When they show the monster, it's not as scary as when they only talk about the monster. Your mind can make things the scariest of all. Like kids who are afraid of what's under the bed. I bet more it feels like everything is under the bed. We don't find out who died and when and how until weeks or months after it happened. When we write a letter to someone, we wonder if that person's already gone. And even folks who haven't lost a son or a husband or a brother are sad because everyone knows someone who lost someone. Every day I see people with tears in their eyes, in the market, just walking down the street. They don't see me see them. I think some of them don't even know they're doing it. For soldiers, dying is everyday life. For us, crying is everyday life. Even when you were so far away, you always tried to look out for me at home. But then you also always wrote that you're no hero, you're no help. But I know what you are, and you know what? I don't care if you don't agree. There are a lot of mean guys around here. I don't see many big brothers sticking up for little brothers the way you have for me. And you taught me how to do it for myself. Here's how I know. I told you about that big storm last winter when we were let out of school early. What I didn't tell you is that when I was walking home by myself, I saw Jed shoveling his driveway even though it was still snowing. I tried to pass without letting him see me, but he grabbed my hood of my coat and pulled me backward. He shoved the shovel at me and said, "Perfect timing, you finish." I looked to his house, and he said his parents weren't home. I said I forgot my mittens in school. He just laughed. Then he asked me if I was going to cry. I didn't say anything. I just shoveled his stupid driveway while he watched. He looked like he couldn't believe I was really doing it. He even started to feel bad. He didn't say I could stop, but he did offer me his mittens. I told him that my brother had been shot at and threatened and insulted and hungry and had to sleep in the mud and hike at night with a heavy pack for hours and live in fear for months and live without his family for years. I told him that if you can do all that, I can shovel a driveway with cold hands. I told him I didn't do it because I was scared, but because it was a nice thing to do, and I told him not to bother me anymore. Then I said, "This war is over." Here's the craziest part. We stood there in silence for a minute, just letting the snow fall on us. Somehow, right then, something changed. Jed said something that surprised us both. He said that he respected you for what you did, and then he called you a hero. I knew that already, and I knew that even before you left home. No matter what you say, I know you're not what you seem to be at first. Like an inflatable tank. All of us still can't believe it. The war took you from us, but then it sent you back. I think they called it honorable discharge. We are luckier than so many families whose boys did not survive January 6th, the invasion of France, like Matt's family. Poor Richard. I know you and Matt weren't exactly friends, but I'm so sorry. The doctor thinks you'll be back on your feet in 6 weeks. You might walk with a limp, but like you said first thing when they brought you home, I still have my life. You're probably wondering why I didn't tell you before about what happened with Jed. It's because I told myself that I wished I could tell you in person, that one day I would be able to tell you in person. But I wrote it down, so if you ever forget what I think of you, no matter where I am and where you are, you'll always be able to reread this to remind yourself. I know you're resting. But nothing is going to stop me from walking down the hall to give this letter to you right now. Love, Charlie. Author's note, World War II, soldiers fight, soldiers right. During World War II, no ground fighting occurred in the United Kingdom. But that doesn't mean nothing dramatic happened there. Before the author researched wartime England, they hadn't considered the enormity, which is a huge amount, of what we now know as something called D-Day, the Allied invasion of Nazi-occupied France. The date was June 6, 1944, the day after Joe's last letter. The author had never wondered just how the Allies could have trained more than 150,000 troops and sneaked them across the English Channel into Normandy. They'd set out from nowhere, from somewhere, and they hadn't known anything about the massive and successful deception. Charlie, Joe, Matt, and Cookie were not real, but the inflatable tanks were. The Allied plan to trick Nazi Germany with dummy vehicles was called Operation Fortitude, and it was part of a larger plan called Operation Bodyguard. Those operation names may sound cool, but this effort is sometimes known by another name that is even cooler, the Ghost Army. With your parents, you can even search up Ghost Army and Inflatable Tanks World War II, and you can see footage of the actual fakes. The Allies actually created two fake armies. The one in the story was in Southeast England, and the other one was in Scotland. And the plans involved more than phony tanks. To increase their chances of fooling Hitler, the Allies also used phony radio transmissions and double agents. In this case, people who pretended to spy on the Allies for the Nazis, but who were actually spying on the Nazis for the Allies. The soldiers of World War II were also the historians. Simply by writing letters to their families, they preserved thousands of smaller stories that took place alongside the big events. Most of these young men didn't plan on being authors any more than they planned on being fighters, but their personal letters home captured a side of the war that journalists couldn't. Numerous cities have World War II museums, including New Orleans, and some display letters from soldiers. If you ever get a chance to visit any of these museums, you will see stories as surprising as Joe's. In real life, soldiers who had a role in Operation Fortitude would not have been able to describe in a letter exactly what they were doing. Therefore, to mention the fake tank in my story, I had to take a liberty. Perhaps that's specially apt here because taking liberty, or rather taking back liberty, is often a driving force of war. Thank you to Sarah Evans for issuing my passport and a time machine for my trip back to 1940s England. P.S. If you don't know what Eisenhower, the general who pets Cookie, did after the war, you might want to look it up. So I just wanted to share that interesting information at the end of this book. So this is the end of Brave Like My Brother by Mark Tyler Nobleman.